is a name that can silence every fear. There's a love that embraces the heartache, the pain, and the tears. Through my faith and my doubting, I know one thing for sure. His word is unfailing, his promise secure. Todo va a estar bien, everything will be alright. Whole world's in his hands, your whole world's in his hands. In the darkness and the trials, he's faithful and he is true. The whole world's in his hands, you told him I'll stop, yeah. Oh, 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 everything will be alright. Oh, oh, oh.
Father, you say everything's gonna be alright, but my circumstances say I won't last through the night. I need your word to hold me now, I need you to pull me through. I need a miracle, a breakthrough, I need you. They say you hold the whole universe in your hand, but my world's falling apart like it is made of sand. Am I small enough to slip through the cracks? Can you take my broken pieces and put them back? Give me faith, you believe you're on my side. Open my eyes and see you working in my life. Let the past remind me you'd never fail, and tell my soul it is well. Oh, y todo va a estar bien, everything will be alright. The whole world's in his hands, your whole world's in his hands. In the darkness, in the trials, he's faithful and he's true. Your whole world's in his hands, y todo va a estar bien.
Padre, te confieso a corazón abierto que todo es muy incierto en este desierto. Mi vulnerabilidad está al descubierto. Siento que mi barca está muy lejos de su puerto. ¿Por qué será que ya no sale el sol en mis días? ¿Por qué mis noches son tan frías? ¿Por qué será que siento que me falta algo? ¿Por qué este camino gris se siente tan largo? Sé que estás sobrando aunque no te sienta. Sé que estás sobrando aunque no te vea. Sé que voy a salir de esta odisea. Sé que voy a ganar esta pelea. Sé que va a cesar esta marea temporaria. Que en ti yo viviré una vida extraordinaria. Y aunque no pueda entender, me consuela saber que
todo, yo sé que todo va a estar bien.
Todo va a estar bien.
Everything will be alright.
The whole world's in his hands. Your whole world's in his hands. In the darkness, in the trials, he's faithful and he's true. Your whole world's in his hands. Y todo va a estar bien. Oh, oh, oh. Everything will be alright.
Everything will be alright.
Oh, oh, oh. Yeah.
Todo va a estar bien.
Todo va a estar bien.
Oh, oh, oh.
He's got the whole world in his hands. He's got the whole world in his hands. He's got the whole wide world in his hands.
Todo el mundo en su mano está. Todo el mundo en su mano está. Todo el mundo en su mano está.
This is Well, good morning. Welcome. Happy Easter. He is risen. He is risen. Amen. Let's stand and worship him.
Forever.
Celebrate that this morning.
And through the darkness, your loving kindness. resurrection in your name, Jesus Christ.
You for the hope that we have in you. The hope alone is only through you, Lord, not through power, money, relationships, any things that we might cling on to in this world. Lord, our hope comes from you and only you alone. Lord, I thank you that you chose to send your only Son to a broken world, to a world of hurt, of pain, and you chose the cross for him. The blood that was spilt for me and for everybody in here, Lord, so that we could simply have a relationship with you, that you loved us that much. Lord, we thank you so much. We thank you for the power that overcame death, overcame the grave, so that we could have eternal life. Lord, I ask that if anybody in here doesn't know you, that you'd speak to them right now. In your name we pray. Amen.
Good morning, church. Happy Easter. He is risen. It is great, great, great to be with you this morning. It is one of those mornings. Hudson is asleep right now, so I am just going to keep wearing him through announcements and see if it sticks. So, man, we are so grateful to have you here this morning to worship with us, to celebrate together with us this morning. If we haven't had a chance to meet, I'm Sam. I'm the pastor of youth and young adults here at Faith Church, and we are so, so grateful that you're here with us this morning. I'd like to invite everyone to download our Faith Church app. That's where you can follow along with notes, but we also have a connection card on there that you can either find on that app or in that seat back in front of you. If this is your first Sunday with us or your first Sunday back in a while, we would love for you to fill out that connection card either on the app or on one of the paper copies in the seat back in front of you. That's just so we can get to know you better, so we can figure out how we can plug you in here at Faith Church. We'd love to be praying for you. We'd love to be walking with you throughout the week, because there are lots of things that go on here at church, not just here on Sunday, but throughout the week. And one of those things is our kids ministry, our youth ministry, which are meeting on Wednesday nights. Our students, they've been so excited for the garage sale. We've been seeing that stuff pile up. So thank you for everyone who's been donating to our garage sale. I'd recommend, again, if you have stuff, just anything you want to get rid of, I would say bring it to the church at 6 p.m. The youth are going to help you unload it. We'll get it in the church, and it's going to go to funding kids' scholarships to go to camp. So thank you for everyone who's donated already, but we're looking forward to that here in a couple weeks. Next thing is a connection class. So if this is kind of your first Sunday back in a while, or maybe you've been coming for a little while, but you're still wondering, how do I get plugged in better here at Faith Church? How do I find out what makes Faith Church, Faith Church? Well, this connection class is for you. This is on April 14th. It's going to be right after service. It's led by Pastor Tyler. It's just a great opportunity to share in a meal together, get to know some people who might be at the same step as you in the church, and also just find out how can we better serve you, and how can you be a part of what's going on in God's kingdom here at Faith Church. So this morning, Tyler's got an Easter message prepared for us. I'm going to pray for him before he heads on up here, but I just want to say thank you again and welcome. Welcome to anyone who's here for the first time this morning. But let's bow together and pray. Father God, I thank you, Lord. I thank you for the sweet, sweet truth of Christ's victory on the cross, God, that when he said it was finished, God, it was finished. But God, it meant that he also had conquered death and he was planning to come back. God, I thank you that we get to celebrate that truth this morning, that Jesus is risen, that he is a risen Savior. Lord, that we worship a God who is very much alive and a God that is active and moving in this place. God, would you continue to move in this place this morning? Would you touch our hearts with that sweet gospel truth that your Son rose from the grave, Lord, Would our faith be put in him this morning? And God, I ask that you just prepare Tyler and his message. And Lord, would you prepare our hearts to receive it? I thank you for Jesus, and it's his name I pray. Amen.
I'll be reading again from the book of Luke, chapter 23, starting in verse 50, if you'd like to follow along. It's also on the screen. Now there was a man named Joseph from the Jewish town of Arimathea. He was a member of the council, a good and righteous man, who had not consented to their decision and action, and he was looking for the kingdom of God. This man went to Pilate and asked for the body of Jesus. Then he took it down and wrapped it in a linen shroud and laid him in a tomb cut in stone, where no one had ever yet been laid. It was the day of preparation, and the Sabbath was beginning. The women who had come with him from Galilee followed and saw the tomb and how his body was laid. Then they returned and prepared spices and ointments. On the Sabbath day, they rested according to the commandment. Continuing on in chapter 24. But on the first day of the week, at early dawn, they went to the tomb, taking the spices they had prepared. And they found the stone rolled away from the tomb. But when they went in, they did not find the body of the Lord Jesus. While they were perplexed about this, behold, two men stood by them in dazzling apparel. And as they were frightened and bowed their faces to the ground, the men said to them, "Why do you seek the living among the dead? He is not here, but he is risen. Remember how he told you while he was still in Galilee that the Son of Man must be delivered into the hands of sinful men and be crucified, and on the third day rise."
Amen. Thank you, Katie. Well, good morning and happy Easter to everyone here. It is a Resurrection Sunday. I was just sharing with somebody before service. This is like the Super Bowl for believers, and yet we're undefeated. Amen? We are undefeated on Resurrection Sunday. The Lord is risen, and we're going to celebrate that together this morning. And we've been traveling through the places of Easter, and today we arrive at the empty tomb. But I want to take us back to how we got to this place. And today we're going to start in the Bible, in the book of Genesis, in chapter 12. And we're going to travel through the Bible to see how we get to the empty tomb and what it means to us as believers. The story begins with three men, Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. And in Genesis chapter 12, God gave a covenant, a promise to Abraham. Verse 1 of chapter 12 says, "Now the Lord said to Abram, 'Go from your country and your kindred and your father's house to the land that I will show you, and I will make you a great nation, and I will bless those, and I will bless you and make your name great so that you will be a blessing. And I will bless those who bless you, and him who dishonors you I will curse. And in you all the families of the earth shall be blessed.'" Abraham was a father, and he moved into this land of Canaan that God had promised to him, called the Promised Land. And he was a very religious man. He was a godly man. He loved God, and he served God. He knew God, and he loved God. And he had a son, Isaac, who caught on quickly, and he was also a good man. And then Isaac had a son named Jacob, who was not a good man. And I don't know if anybody in here this morning had a very godly grandfather, grandmother, godly parents, maybe even godly siblings, but you might be sitting here and you just don't quite get it. You've maybe looked at the other way, and if there is any other way. And I meet people like that all the time. And what it tells me is that just because you're born into a good family, just because you're around church, doesn't make you godlier than other people. It doesn't make you a good person. Because we see Jacob, who was born into a great family, yet he stole everything he ever had. He stole his father's blessing. He stole his father's inheritance. And back then, they didn't have inheritance like stocks or land. They were nomadic people. They lived in tents. So land was, it was like a commodity. It was easy to come by. But this blessing was what the father had to give to their son. And this is what Jacob stole from his brother and from his father. He stole this birthright. And so he escaped. He went, and he went north to his uncle, and it turns out Jacob gets married. Jacob begins to have children. Jacob actually gets married twice, has two wives and two concubines as well, and starts to have many children. But we see still that Jacob is not yet a quote-unquote good guy. He is stealing, and he's having this conflict now with his uncle. So he decides to leave. He goes back to this land. And this is, again, in Genesis, 2,000 years before Christ, in the story that we're going to get to today. And we're 2,000 years after Christ, so this is about 4,000 years ago. And here Jacob comes, and he realizes about halfway back home is that he has to have an interaction with his brother, Esau. So just like you would do if you're looking to make amends with somebody, he decides to send gifts ahead, right? If you've ever wronged somebody and you kind of want to make amends, you might buy them a card and send it ahead of time, or send them a quick note or a text letting them know, like, hey, I'm coming. I'm going to be around. And so that's what Jacob's doing. He's sending out his family ahead, and he sends out first his children and some a wife, and then some other children, and then it's Rachel and his two beloved children, and then it's Jacob. And he's sending them ahead, and they're on the south side of the river, and Jacob decides he's going to stay on the north side of the river. To me, this is a big chicken move, right? Jacob is like, y'all go ahead. By the time it gets to me, if he kills y'all, I know there's no hope for me. So this is where Jacob is at in his life. And Esau is coming towards him, and Jacob has to decide how this interaction is going to work. And remember, up until this point in Jacob's life, he does not have a relationship with God. But on the other side of that brook, that evening, before his confrontation with his brother, he encountered God. He encountered God, and we read about this in Genesis chapter 32. In Genesis 32, in verse 27, Jacob had wrestled with the angel of the Lord all night until the day had broken, and finally, the angel said, let me go. Jacob said, I will not let you go unless you bless me. And he said to him, what is your name? And he said, Jacob. Then he said, your name shall no longer be Jacob, but Israel, for you have striven with God and with men and have prevailed. We see here that Jacob had an encounter with God and everything changed. Everything changed for him. And God came to him and showed himself to him, and he spoke to him. And what I want us to realize here this morning as we reflect on the resurrection is that God speaks to us. God speaks to us. He speaks to people. And Jacob went from being a deceiver to the father of Israel. And you think about this, 4,000 years ago, he was given the name Israel, and this body of people, this country that was established today, is named what? Israel. From this moment in time where God spoke to Jacob. And I want us to realize that God speaks to us. The same God that spoke to Jacob 4,000 years ago speaks to us today. Through his Holy Spirit, through his word, through creation, God reveals himself to us. And hopefully through God speaking to you, you can come before him through his son Jesus, just like we were singing about a moment ago. You can experience that living hope. The story continues on from 2,000 years before Christ to about 1,500 years before Christ in the book of Exodus. And in Exodus, we read about this man named Moses. Now, Moses was born into a good family. He wasn't born into royalty, but he was raised by royalty. We saw that he was adopted into Pharaoh's family, into his Pharaoh's house. Pharaoh was a pagan king, the emperor of Egypt, and for 40 years, Moses grew up in this house. He associated himself with the gods of Egypt until he realized he was not an Egyptian. He was a son of Abraham, of Isaac, and Jacob. And he was a part of the children of Israel who were now enslaved there in Egypt. And I've been to Egypt before. I've seen the pyramids, been to the Valley of the Kings, Valley of the Queens. And more than likely, all these great things that are still have lasted till today were built during that time when Israel were slaves in Egypt. And there, in that Egyptian area, we see that Moses came and realized he was a person of Israel. And he ended up killing a man. And so what does Moses do? He decides to run. He runs away. He goes to Sinai, that Sinai Peninsula there between Egypt and Israel today. And he runs away, and he's there for 40 years. So he was 40, add another 40, and he's about 80 years old now. And he was shepherding. He was married, and he's shepherding up in these mountains in the Sinai Peninsula. And there he comes across a bush that's on fire. And it wasn't just a thing that kind of caught him off guard, because the kinetic energy between the heat and things, there'd be little fires all around. But what was different about this fire is that it was not consuming the bush. And as Moses was there, the Lord spoke to him in that burning bush. And we read about this in Exodus chapter 3, starting in verse 4. When the Lord saw that he, Moses, turned aside to see, God called to him out of the bush, "Moses, Moses." And he said, "Here I am." Then he said, "Do not come near. Take your sandals off your feet, for the place on which you are standing is holy ground." And he said, "I am the God of your father, the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, and the God of Jacob." And Moses hid his face, for he was afraid to look at God. Then the Lord said, "I have surely seen the affliction of my people who are in Egypt, and have heard their cry because of their taskmasters. I know their suffering, and I have come down to deliver them out of the hand of the Egyptians and to bring them up out of that land to a good and broad land, a land flowing with milk and honey, to the place of the Canaanites, the Hittites, Amorites, Perizzites, and Hivites, and the Jebusites. Now behold, the cry of the people of Israel has come to me, and I have also seen the oppression with which the Egyptians oppressed them." He said, "Come, I will send you to Pharaoh, that you may bring my people, the children of Israel, out of Egypt." But Moses said to God, "Who am I that I should go to Pharaoh and bring the children of Israel out of Egypt?" He said, "But I will be with you, and this shall be a sign for you that I have sent you. When you have brought the people out of Egypt, you shall serve God on this mountain." Here's Moses, and he's asking God, "How can I do this? I can't even speak to people. The only people I've spoken to are like my family and maybe a few other shepherds for the last 40 years. How am I supposed to go speak to this most powerful man in the world? If not his stepbrother, then his stepbrother's son, so his stepnephew at this time, he's saying, how can I go back to him and speak to him? And God says, "I'm going to give you two things. I'm going to give you your brother, Aaron, who's a very good speaker, and I'm going to give you a rod. And I'm going to give that to you, and with this rod, you will do great things because I will be with you." And you know the story. It's an amazing story that Moses went to Egypt, spoke to Pharaoh, and he said, "Let my people go." And what did Pharaoh say? No. Over and over, he said no. And what happened? The river turned to blood. There were gnats. There were locusts. There were frogs. There was death. All these things going on, plague after plague. And after every one of them, Pharaoh said no. I would have thought that Pharaoh would have got the idea after like three or four, right? But we know that there was this tenth plague that came, which we heard about a few weeks ago. And it was the establishment of the Passover and what the Passover was about, because God was going to send the death angel to every home, Jew, Gentile, Egyptian, every stranger. They were going to come face to face with this death angel unless the blood of a lamb was put on the doorpost and the side post of the house, and the angel would pass over it. That's where the word Passover comes from. So this death angel passed over every house that had the blood of the lamb over its door. And finally, Pharaoh said, "Yes, go. Go away." And Moses, he already told people, be ready. Have your sandals on. Have your shoes on. Because when this happens, we need to be ready to go. And that's what they did. But to me, I read this story, and then we get to this point where I think Moses had a brain block for a minute because they're traveling, and all of a sudden they're in front of this huge sea, right? Like, which direction? I almost think like he forgot where he was going. And we know that Pharaoh decided that he didn't like what he had just done. He was going to go back after the people of Israel. And so here we are. We have the Israelites between a giant body of water and the Egyptian army coming after them. There could have been maybe two people that could swim across and make it all the way across, but it was a good distance across the Red Sea. And so they're standing there, and the people are saying, have you brought us here to die? Moses, what are you going to do? And I'll tell you what the Lord did. The Lord drove back the sea, and the people of Israel walked across on dry ground. Exodus 14 tells us this, how God provided for his people. Did Pharaoh die? I don't know. We know a lot of the Egyptian army who followed them in were lost because God closed the water upon them. But Moses, he went from being a murderer to a deliverer. And what do we talk about Moses? We talk about him delivering. And what do we get from this? First, we know that God speaks to us, just like he spoke to Jacob. But we also know from Moses, we can also understand that God provides for us. God provides for us. He provided for his people then, and he provides for his people now. He speaks to us, and he provides for us. The story moves on about 1000 BC, and we read in 1 Samuel chapter 17 about a man named David. A man named David, and this is probably the most famous story in the whole Old Testament, because, you know, David went up against a big guy named Goliath. The story of David and Goliath, the big versus small. And we need to now understand that Israel has been conformed into a country, and it's doing very well. And all these countries around Israel don't like that. They want a part of that. So they're coming in, they're constantly, these wars and battles happening. And one of these groups of people were called the Philistines. And what's interesting is that the Philistines are in the area of Gaza today. And we know, if you know anything about the news in Israel, is that the area of Gaza, it's no longer the Philistines, but the Palestinians. And there is still conflict there today. I always like to use in my sermon, I'm a father of three girls, and I'm a big Disney princess aficionado. So according to Frozen 2, the very beginning line, if you know, is some things never change. And that's what exactly is happening here. There is conflict then, and there is conflict now. And this hasn't changed in over 3,000 years. And there's still a problem here. And these Philistines are coming up, and they're telling Israel, right? Let's not have everybody die. They send down their best warrior, Goliath. And he comes and he taunts them every day. And he says, send me somebody, one on one. And they're in the middle of this valley. And both sides are there. And they're just waiting. They're camped out waiting for, they have scouts down there waiting to see if somebody's going to ambush them and whatnot. And there Goliath is yelling, let's fight one on one to the death. And whoever wins, wins. Well, David was the youngest son of Jesse, and his father had told him to go down to the battle, check on his brothers. So David goes down. It's about 16 miles south from where he was at. About, for him as a young lad, it's probably a day journey. He could get there maybe a day and a half. And he goes down there, and he hears this man, Goliath. And in David's mind, he's saying, who's going to fight this man? Who's going to stand up for the Lord and fight Goliath? This guy, probably over 8 feet tall, a giant. And here's David. I think he's about 5'5", right? He's saying, who's going to go up against this man? And David's brothers are saying, David, just be quiet. Don't be dumb. Like, you're the annoying little brother, right? Some of us have those. I was that brother, but some of you guys have those brothers. And that's what they're saying. Just mind your business. And David goes to Saul. And what does the king say? Okay, we have somebody. And he gives him his armor, but the armor doesn't fit. And he says that he's just going to go out there with a sling. And if we know, Jacob was a shepherd. Moses was a shepherd. David was a shepherd. And David was used to taking care of his flocks. And he's saying, yes, I have killed a lion. I have killed a bear. And I'm just going to take my sling out there. And it wasn't like one of these slings like I had growing up, and you guys probably had growing up, a slingshot with a little Y, and you'd pull back the string, and you'd shoot whatever you could find that could shoot, right? Rocks, you know, if you got good, you wanted to get a pencil just placed perfectly on there and launch it like an arrow. It wasn't like one of those slingshots. It was literally two pieces of string with a little leather strap in the middle, and you would swing it around and around. And I don't know if you've ever tried to do a slingshot like that, but the accuracy, you have to be really good to get it to go where you want it to go. Like, I've tried it before, and it either just falls out, or it goes that way, or that way. But David said, I will take my sling. And he goes down with his sling, this piece of twine, and stands before Goliath. And in 1 Samuel 17, says that David took a stone and killed what is known as one of the biggest warriors. The Philistine said to David, come to me, and I will give your flesh to the birds of the air and to the beasts of the field. And it was there David, with his sling, stood up for God and said this to the Philistine, you come to me with a sword and with a spear and with a javelin, but I come to you in the name of the Lord of hosts, the God of the armies of Israel, whom you have defiled. And he continues, this day the Lord will deliver you into my hand, and I will strike you down and cut off your head. And I will give the dead bodies of the host of the Philistines this day to the birds of the air and to the wild beasts of the earth, that all the earth may know that there is a God in Israel, and that all this assembly may know that the Lord saves, not with a sword and spear, for the battle is the Lord's, and he will give you into our hand. God is telling David, do you know what I can do with you? God doesn't look at our height. God doesn't look at our abilities. God doesn't look at our bank accounts. He doesn't look at all these other things that make us mighty. God looks at us and he says, I will use you. I will use you because you will have my strength. David had the strength of the Lord. And the same strength that God gave to David, he gives to us today. He gives us strength. He gives us courage. You see, he spoke to Jacob. He provided for Moses. And for David, he gave him strength. Now let's get closer to the story that we're going to be looking at today. And we'll look at a woman named Mary. You all remember Mary? You can come back at Christmas and you'll learn a lot more about Mary, but for the sake of today, we're going to keep it short. Mary was probably 15 years old when we're introduced to her, and an angel comes to her and says, do not be afraid. Do not be afraid. In Luke chapter 1, let's read together in we'll start in verse 26. In the sixth month, the angel Gabriel was sent from God to a city of Galilee named Nazareth, to a virgin betrothed to a man whose name was Joseph, of the house of David. And the virgin's name was Mary. And he came to her and said, greetings, O favored one, the Lord is with you. But she was greatly troubled at the saying, and tried to discern what sort of greeting this might be. And the angel said to her, do not be afraid, Mary, for you have found favor with God. Mary, being fearful, understood she was chosen. She was chosen by God. And this is the part that gets me every time, is that we as people need to realize is that God chooses us. He chooses us. He chose Mary, and you might go to yourself, well, Mary's Mary. We read about how holy she was, how blameless she was, and she's better than I am. And there's probably not a there's probably no doubt about that, right? Mary was understandably a godly, holy person. But please, I want us to understand as you sit here in this room is that God chooses you. God has chosen you. And why does he choose us? He chooses us when we're in our fear, when we're caught and we're stuck in fear and afraid. And he chooses us and he hears us. And I want us to realize if we go back to David in Psalm chapter 40, what happened when David was afraid, David wrote many psalms. But Psalm chapter 40, we read that David cried out to God and God inclined his ear to David. You guys know what inclining your ear means? It means literally putting your hand up to your ear and going like this, right? Some of you guys may say, well, I do that all the time because I don't hear as good as I once did. But literally, it becomes a sounding board so you can hear better. And that's what God does for us when we pray. He goes, I am listening. And he hears us. And he inclines his ear to us. And we read through that psalm how God picks David up out of the miry clay and sets his feet upon a rock. And we rejoice in that because he does the same thing for us. God hears us when we are afraid. He hears us in our sorrow, in our pain, in our suffering. And it's a beautiful picture from David to Mary and what God does for us. And now the story changes. We read that God told Mary she was going to have a son, and you can just turn a page into Luke chapter 2 and read about the birth of Christ, because from Abraham and Isaac and Jacob to Moses to David to Mary, God was working with each and every one of them a little bit differently. But all of it was for this purpose, is because God was going to send his son. God sent his son. God made a choice of not just coming and speaking and providing and helping and listening, but he sent his son to us, to Bethlehem. And this is a little bit different as I think about that. Like, why did God choose to send his son to Bethlehem? He could have sent his son through Egypt, one of the most powerful nations in the world back then. He could have gone through Babylon. He could have gone through these world powers. But this little known town of Bethlehem, we all know about it today because God sent his son through Bethlehem, but this little village, nobody knew Bethlehem. Bethlehem was a small town. I could probably say Bethlehem was like a valley center. Don't be offended at that. We like that kind of title. We're a small town, right? But you see, Bethlehem was a small town and nobody knew where it was. And while they were there, it was interesting that the circumstances came about. In Luke chapter 2, we read about it in verse 7. And she, Mary, gave birth to her firstborn son and wrapped him in swaddling cloths and laid him in a manger because there was no room for them in the inn. God sent his son for us. The Bible says in John 3:16 that God loved the world, that he sent his one and only son. He sent his son for us. And I get a lot of encouragement from that. It's because I look at Bethlehem, I look at the circumstances where God sent his son, and I realize is that he sent his son for me. I can relate to that. I can relate that in this circumstance, when God sent his son, he did it for me. And we read through the Gospels, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, about how Jesus grew up. He went into ministry. He preached lots of great sermons, did lots of great miracles, all these great things. And we would hear him say, my time is not yet come. His hour isn't here yet. But last week, during the Passover, when God was preparing the people to prepare a lamb for sacrifice, we read about the triumphal entry of Jesus on that Palm Sunday. And it's coming towards Easter, and that Friday changed everything. It changed everything. And Jesus said at that time, "My time is here. I will be crucified and I will die." And he allowed himself to be crucified and die for us. He died for us. He could have walked away. He could have gotten away. He could have not chosen that part, but he chose to go to the cross for us. He willingly laid down his life for us. And when we read those words, "For God so loved the world," we need to realize that we are the world. Sometimes in my mind, I can comprehend, yes, I know God loves us and he loves the world and gave his son for the world. But sometimes I don't quite grasp and I forget, like, how could God do that for me? And I need to place my name in there because I am the world. And you need to place your name in there because you are the world. Jesus gave himself for you, and he died for you. And we read in John 19, in the end of the story, about how they tried to, you know, give him something to drink, something to eat, all this stuff, and Jesus kept pushing it away, and he finally said these words, "It is finished." And what happened? What happened is that the innocent took on guilt so that the guilty could become innocent. The innocent took on guilt, so the guilt, the one who carries it, the guilty, that we could become innocent. We need to understand that Jesus died for everyone, for humanity, and he didn't deserve to die. He went to the cross for us because Jesus never sinned. We know the penalty for sin is death, and death separated from God for eternity. And Jesus never once sinned. He was the only person who ever walked this earth who was able to take upon the sins of the world because he was fully man, yet he was fully God. He was innocent but became guilty for us. That's what 2 Corinthians 5:21 tells us, is that for our sake, he made him, God made Jesus, who knew no sin, to become sin for us, so that in him we might become the righteousness of God. And then at the end, they buried him. They put him in a tomb. Why? Because that's what you do with dead people. You bury them. Jesus really died. He really was buried. And what we celebrate today is that Jesus rose. He is risen. And we serve a risen Savior. And there is amazing power in that the tomb is empty. And as Katie just read in Luke 24, the angels said, "Why do you look for the living amongst the dead? He is not here. He has risen as he said." Jesus came to die so that we may live. And he rose again, and this amazing thing, as we read in our theology, as Paul writes in the New Testament about how Christ died for our sins in accordance with the Scriptures, with these accounts of these eyewitnesses in the Gospels. And then he was buried, and he rose again on the third day in accordance with the Scriptures. He goes on to write, if all of this did not happen, we are the ones that should be pitied the most. The world should feel bad for us if this really didn't happen. And we need to see that this story, this life-changing event, the greatest event in the history of the world when Jesus rose from the dead, it's either true or it's a bunch of malarkey. And we need to understand is that we have a decision to make. You have a decision to make. Is it true? Do you believe it? Or do you not? Have you been brought from death to life through Jesus? Is Jesus Christ your Lord and Savior? Because we know it's by grace we have been saved through faith. It's not by any works that we have done, lest anyone should boast. It is the grace of God that causes this for us. And I can tell you that everyone here is at least interested in the Bible a little bit, or you wouldn't be here this morning. There's a little bit of interest in here for everybody. And what we need to realize that even if you're here because somebody invited you, if you're here because your family's here, if you're not a follower of Jesus Christ, if you haven't committed your life to following Jesus as your Lord and Savior, you're not a part of God's family yet. And we have to realize is that there's only two people who can pay for your sins. You can pay for your sins and be separated from God forever in a very real place called hell. Or Jesus can pay for your sins, and he can give you eternal life in the presence of God in heaven for eternity. And we need to realize this, is that we need to come to that point in that moment of time and realize, is this true for us, or is it malarkey? Did Jesus rise again from the dead, or did he not? Because I want us to understand, just being around the church, just being around a good Christian family, doesn't make you Christian. Jacob was born into a great family, a godly family, and he never got it until he came and had an encounter with God. People, we need to have that encounter with God. If you've never encountered him before, he is calling you today through his Holy Spirit and through his word. He loves you. God loves you. He loves you so much that he gave his one and only son for you. And as we close, I want us to remember five things. What does this mean to us? What does Easter mean to us? What does the resurrection mean to us? And I just want you to hold out your hand because I want you to remember these five things. These are five things that if you remember these, you can understand that you, how you can become a child of God, and that when you believe, you will always be a child of God. First is that God loves you. God loves you. Second, we must come to the understanding is that we have sinned. I have sinned. But God, in his great love for us, sent his son to die for us. Christ died for you. And if you believe, you will be saved. That's the gospel. That is why God came and sent his son. We can try and blame Adam and Eve, but can I tell you what? I have sinned. I hate to break it to you. If you didn't know, you have sinned. All have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. And the problem is that the penalty for our sin, the wages that we get, the payment for our sin is death. But the gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord. And one day, you will spend eternity in one of two places. And either you will pay for your sin, or you'll stand before the Father and you'll say, I'm with him. I'm with Jesus. He has paid for my sin because Christ died for you. And if you believe, you will be saved. Saved from what? Saved from your sin. Saved from hell. Saved back into relationship with God. And can I tell you, the same God that gave Jacob relationship, the same God that gave Moses relationship, the same God that gave David and Mary relationship, he wants a relationship with you. God gave his son so that you could have relationship with him. John 3:16 says this, for God so loved the world. And just pause there for a moment and put your name in there as I read this. For God so loved me, that he gave his only son, that whoever believes in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. And some of us may be sitting here and be thinking, well, God, how can he love me? How can he love this person? They are a bad person. But we need to realize that we can also point at ourselves. There's only one perfect person who ever walked this earth, and that is God's son, Jesus. And he didn't come to point his finger at you, and I know I'm not supposed to point at people, but God came not to condemn the world, as this next verse says. to condemn the world. He didn't come to him. My friends, the only way through to the Father is through the Son. The only way to God is through Jesus. And he died for you. And he was buried, and he rose again. And that tomb is empty. And all of us here today need to come to grips with that. The tomb is empty, and where do we stand? As we prepare to close, I'm going to have the worship team come up, and we're going to sing a song. But I'd like us all to stand at this moment. I'm going to ask us to stand. I'm going to ask us to have our heads bowed and eyes closed. Because I realize we have many people here today that may be coming to grips with where you stand with God. And that's not always easy. It's not always easy to come to grips with where you stand with God. But with heads bowed and eyes closed, I have a question that I want to ask you. That there may be a person in this room who hasn't come to grips, who hasn't come to terms in coming to the Father through his Son. And with head bowed and eyes closed, I'm going to pray. And then if you need to pray this prayer, I'm going to ask you from your seats, if you need to confess to the Lord God that Jesus is Lord, and that he is your Savior, and you need to be saved from your sins, just pray this with me. Father God, thank you for loving me. Thank you for sending your Son, Jesus, to die for me. Lord, I am a sinner. I've messed up. But I believe in your Son, Jesus, in his death, in his burial, and in his resurrection. In that same power that rose Jesus from the dead, you offer to me that gift of salvation. Lord, I receive your Son. I place my trust in him. I confess that he is Lord. I ask you to be my Savior. Lord, I believe. Thank you for loving me. Thank you for dying on the cross for me and raising again to bring me life. With head bowed and eyes closed, if you prayed that prayer, would you just raise your hand so I can pray for you? Yes, thank you. I'll be praying for each of those hands. And maybe you're standing here with head bowed and eyes closed and you have come to grips with where you stand, but you haven't been living that way. Maybe you need to take a step back to the Father. I'm going to pray for you, and after I pray, the worship team is going to play a song. And I want you to listen to those words of that song and sing them from your heart, because God is calling you today to come back to him. We serve a risen Savior. Father God, we come before you. Lord, I thank you for the hands that were just raised a moment ago, that they prayed to put their trust and faith in the work of your Son, Jesus. Lord, I pray that they won't stay quiet about their decision, but they will speak out about the joy and the forgiveness and the grace that comes through him. Lord, it is a life-changing moment when we experience you for the first time. We can experience your grace and your mercy. Lord, I pray for each person in this room that they will experience that same hope, that living hope that comes through your Son. And that we will go out and boldly proclaim that he is alive. Lord, use us to be your church, to be your people, to proclaim your name to the world, that others too might experience him. We love you, Lord, and it's in your holy name that we pray. Amen. As we sing, I'm going to be up here. If you need prayer, we'll have somebody in the back as well at the Next Steps table. If you need prayer, come forward, go to the back. We would love to pray with you, help you along your journey and your relationship with the Lord. Let's sing together this morning.
Come to the end of the sight.
takes our sorrow, he takes our guilt, he takes our shame, and he gives us life. And for each and every person in this room, I don't know what you're going through. I don't know what your week looks like ahead. I don't know what your week looked like last week. But I encourage you, first, if you made a decision, find us in the back. Take that next step. We'd love to connect with you and how you can take your next step in following Jesus. If you need prayer, find one of us there at the back tables. We'd love to connect with you and pray with you and how we can walk with you while the Lord has us here. And again, if you're visiting, we'd love to connect with you. We'd love to tell you more about what is going on here at Faith Church and in the life and the experiences we have as a body of believers. To do what that last line in that song just said, to tell the world of the treasure we have. The gift of Jesus that we have, that he calls us to go and to give to others. Let me pray for you as we close here on this Easter Sunday. And I'm going to send us out to go and be the church that God has called, and it's their first Sunday. Lord, I pray that you will be working in us. Lord, that you will break our hearts for what breaks yours. Lord, as Jesus hung on that cross and took upon the weight of the sins of the world, he was thinking of us. And Lord, as we experience that and experience the newness of life that comes through your Son and the eternal life that he brings, Lord, let us not stop there. Let us take it to the world. Let us take it to those around us so that they too may experience the eternal life through Jesus Christ. Lord, we thank you that the tomb is empty, that we serve a risen Savior. The grave could not keep him, but the power, your power, rose him from the grave. And Lord, we experience that same power as believers because you give us your Holy Spirit. So Lord, we ask, may your Spirit be moving amongst us and within us. May you be walking with us as we come and as we go. And as we go, may we realize as we celebrate today and each day of our lives, the price that was paid, but the hope that we have in Jesus, that he is alive. And it is in your holy, holy, holy name that we pray. Amen. Thank you.